The health department assures Filipinos the country remains polio-free, but Health Assistant Secretary Dr. Maria Rosario Vergere warns the Philippines is at high risk of polio virus transmission due to very low vaccine coverage and poor sanitary conditions and practices. Last July, the Research Institute for Tropical Medicine discovered a vaccine-derived polio virus in a sewage in Manila, raising concerns about the reemergence of polio in the country. The World Health Organization declared the Philippines polio-free in October 2000. Meanwhile, the Philippine Health Department has not recorded any case of wild polio virus in 26 years since 1993. And we now have on the line Health Secretary Francisco Duque for more of his thoughts on polio. Good afternoon, sir.
Yes, good afternoon, and to all your viewers and listeners in behalf of the DOH.
Welcome, Secretary. So that's been 19 years since we've been polio-free, but what is the likelihood that the Philippines may soon have cases?
Well, that risk stands, and unless we do what we need to do, which is to raise immediately the polio vaccine coverage to 95% and address the poor or suboptimal environmental sanitation and hygiene, we will face that risk. So the DOH has immediately, after the isolates were identified as vaccine-derived polio virus by the RITM from a collection done at the sewer lines of Manila, we immediately got together to plan the course of action, which is the conduct of polio vaccine campaign or PATAC campaign in Metro Manila for Manila in round one. And then in round two, we will have again Manila and the rest of the NCR. And round three, Manila, the rest of NCR, and region three and region 4A as well.
This vaccine-derived polio virus, can you explain to us what kind of actual threat it poses, how it's circulated, you know, who are the most vulnerable people to it?
Well, the vaccine-derived polio virus, per se, should not cause harm. But since this is a live attenuated virus, it can have the it can mutate. In other words, to assume the virulence of the wild polio virus, so it can be dangerous, and that is why. The way that one contracts the disease, the poliomyelitis, is through the fecal-oral route, which means there's a contamination from the feces to the hands of children, and then, you know, they take food inside their mouth, and so that's how you get infected. That is the fecal-oral route. And the children are most vulnerable, but it can affect up to children 15 years and below. But the children 5 years younger and younger are the most vulnerable sector.
There have been some concerns, Mr. Secretary, that weak surveillance of individuals who have symptoms of polio, such as flaccid paralysis. How do people or communities test for polio nationwide?
Well, the acute flaccid paralysis is an indicator. Instead of looking directly and testing for possible polio virus, the protocol states that you need to narrow down the target population from where you will test the isolates, the feces, and bring them to RITM. And the acute flaccid paralysis is a common symptom among five or six other infection and other conditions, you know, Guillain-Barré, multiple sclerosis, and poliomyelitis. So you would like to narrow down the set of the population, and then you test for whether they are positive for a polio-derived vaccine, mm-hmm. vaccine-derived polio virus. Mm-hmm. And then if it's negative, thank God, you know. But if it's positive, then you have to isolate them, treat them.
Meaning, Mr. Secretary, if you're testing for polio, then your samples would have to be brought to RITM in Manila. There is no testing centers nationwide apart from there.
Yes, you need to bring it to RITM for definitive testing. The way to manage the case of poliomyelitis due to a wild polio virus, which we don't have, and we haven't seen any victim of polio. It's just that it is in the environment. It was found to be in the sewer lines. So the person or the child who contracts the disease, there's really no treatment to speak of. The 95% of the victims will show no symptoms, while 4% will have viral-like symptoms or flu-like symptoms, which may include headache, fever, muscle pains, and diarrhea, abdominal pains, pain and stiffness at the back of the neck, and the back as well as the legs could lead to pain of the muscles, and eventually paralysis might result. And in fact, 1% will develop paralysis, and of the 1%, 0.5% will develop permanent or lifetime paralysis. Mm-hmm. And 0.1% may die during the acute phase of the infection.
Mr. Secretary, we were just speaking with the World Health Organization's Philippine expert, and she said our very low vaccine coverage is alarming, 66% immunized against polio in 2018. But you at the DOH are conducting synchronized polio immunization, which started in August. What's the target and schedule for nationwide coverage?
Well, the round one should have been concluded last August 31st, but mm-hmm. because the feedback to me is that the coverage only reached 49%, I said this is not acceptable. So I had asked them to extend the campaign, the polio vaccination campaign of round one. So they continue to do their house-to-house, and by October, we will run the same campaign, round two, to include Metro Manila. And then round three will be Region 3 and 4A.
Why these areas only, Mr. Secretary? And how many kids are we targeting here?
Well, about 5.5 million is being targeted here.
Eastern Visayas recorded the lowest oral polio coverage, followed by Calabarzon and Cagayan Valley. Again, who are the most at risk for polio at this point, and what's the best way to prepare against it, as a last point?
Well, it's still doing the AFP, the acute flaccid paralysis surveillance, and doing testing of sewer lines, and getting isolates for confirmatory testing with the RITM. The regional directors of the DOH are monitoring the situation, not only in the initial sites for the campaign, but it may expand if the indicators will point out to the need for extending the polio campaign, then that will be done.
Oh, hopefully the campaign is successful. Thank you so much for joining us today, Health Secretary Francisco Duque. We appreciate your time and thoughts, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.